house prayer. Remember your mercies, O Lord. With your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, your sons and daughters, gathered here this evening, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering accustomed to infirmity, one of those for whom people hide their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each followed in his own way, but the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away, and who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sins of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his infliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's responsorial psalm is, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Rescue me. Into your hands I commend my spirit. You will redeem me, O Lord, O faithful God.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
For all my foes, I am an object of reproach, a laughingstock to my neighbors and a dread to my friends. They who see me abroad flee from me. I am forgotten like the unremembered dead. I am like a dish that is broken.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.
But my trust is in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God. In your hands is my destiny. Rescue me from the clutches of my enemies and my persecutors.
Father, to your hands I commend my spirit.
Let your face shine upon your servant. Save me in your kindness. Take courage and be stout-hearted, all you who hope in the Lord.
Father, into your hand I commend my spirit.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the ones who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obeyed him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden, into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him, "He said to them,
I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"I told you that I am, so if you're looking for me, let this man go."
This was to fulfill that he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter, he said,
I am not.
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made, because it was cold, and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather, and in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
Is this the way you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
What charge do you bring against this man?
They answered and said to him,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews answered him, In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back to the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own? Or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
Then you are the king?
Jesus answered.
You say so. You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him. But you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again. Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak, and they came to him and said, They struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out. Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered, Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back to the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
Behold your king.
They cried out. Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priests answered. Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and, carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read this inscription, because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another, In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus where his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
It is finished.
And bowing his head,
Was new. Jesus, remember us when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember us when you come into your kingdom. That's right.
Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden was a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated. Okay, I'm going to say a few words before we go into the next phase of our liturgy today. And first of all, I want to say, be happy. I want to say congratulations. All the story that we heard, beginning with the stations, and the passion story that we heard is just to benefit you and I. Aren't we lucky to be Christians that he had to die in order to bring us salvation? We're in the military, right? Every commander, you all, see some line officers here. You guys, when you command, you want to be able to tell your boss someday, mission accomplished. That's all Jesus wanted to do. He was sent by the Father to forgive us, to die for our own sins. And he had one mission, to go back to the Father and say, mission accomplished. Someday, if you read Matthew chapter 25, talks about the last day, the day of judgment. He wants to gather all of us whom he has saved and present to the Father on the day of judgment and say, Father, I told you, mission accomplished on that day of judgment. We have to do our own part. He has shown us the way. He has given us the do's and the don'ts. We have to fall in line. He is a merciful Lord. Jesus is so merciful. We take one step towards him, he takes several steps towards us, always ready to embrace us, to forgive us. We know the ultimate way that he did it today. We read it today in the Gospel of John chapter 18. Last Sunday, I talked about the seven words that Jesus said on the cross, right? One of the ones that I love the most is the one that says, it is finished. That was the last thing he said in the Gospel of John. It is finished. Then he bowed his head and died. You know why he said it is finished? Back in the day, archaeologists excavated a small box, and it was written in Aramaic, it is finished. They found out that that's what a family gets when they have finished paying their taxes. They don't owe, they cannot relax. They can sleep without worrying about their taxes. When your family gets that's almost like IRS telling you, you know what? It's April 15 and beyond, you are good until next year. You relax. Jesus used the terminology of the people at that time to let them understand that your sins are completely wiped away, that the sins are all forgiven. It is finished. And that's why I say congratulations to you and I today, to all the Christians around the world, for us to know that it is finished. It's a good thing. We have to turn around, say thank you to Jesus. We have to also turn around and continue to find ways to do better. We are not perfect human beings. None of us is perfect. But he wants us to continue to try. May the grace that we receive at this liturgical celebration today, may the prayers and the blessings of God continue to help us to appreciate those words. It is finished. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We will now have extended prayers of petition. If you stand, please. Let us pray for the church.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her, and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name through Christ our Lord. Amen. For the Pope.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Let us kneel. Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord. Amen. For all orders and degrees of the faithful.
Let us pray also for our bishop, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Let's kneel. I pray for you and your families. for good health, for peace, and for the special prayers that you hold the silence of your hearts on this day. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord. Amen. For the unity of Christians, Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord. Amen. For those who do not believe in God,
let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant we pray that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord. Amen. For those in public office,
let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
I will stand. Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of your peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those you govern with authority, who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and the freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And for those in tribulation,
let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Let us kneel. Stand. Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord. Amen. At this time, we are about to conclude. We're going to enter the second to the last phase of our liturgy today, which is the adoration of the cross. We'll do it a little bit different this year because of COVID. So I will go back with my wonderful altar server, and we'll come back, and I will place the crucifix right here. You just come up. You can either bow or genuflect. Don't touch the crucifix today because of the restrictions that we have. And after that, we'll receive communion and conclude. Our response will be, come, let us adore. Behold the wounds of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. Behold the wood of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. Behold the wood of the cross on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. The last, as you pray, the last phase of our liturgy today, we'll go back now. Since this is the only day we cannot celebrate Mass, the communion that we use today was already consecrated. So we're going to go back to the Blessed Sacrament room, bring back the communion, and we do communion and dismiss. will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and glory are yours now and forever. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Again, thank you for your faith. Thank you for joining us. I know a lot of people are traveling this weekend, being a four-day holiday, four-day weekend. So thank you for your time. We gather again tomorrow at 1900. We gather here, we'll be here, and then we step outside, start with the liturgy of the light, right outside, and then we'll come in and just we'll listen to the readings about our salvation and celebrate the Easter Vigil. That will be our Easter Mass. Because I'm not traveling so early on Sunday, I'll be available at 11 o'clock as well on Sunday for anybody who did not make it tomorrow in the evening. Just like yesterday, we're also gonna depart in silence today because we have to put ourselves in the shoes of the apostles. Their master was taken and crucified. The only thing we're gonna leave here is the cross at the center, because this is all we think of today. And that's why the only time we can genuflect to the cross is on this day, thinking of the crucifix, the cross, as the center of our salvation history.